again for Melody Ranch and Gene Autry.
I'm back in the saddle again, out where a friend is a friend, where the longhorn cattle feed on the lowly Jimson weed. I'm back in the saddle again.
That's right, folks. It's another visit with all the gang here at Melody Ranch. There's Pat Buttram, the Cass County Boys, the Gene Autry Blue Jeans, Carl Kottner's Melody Ranch Hardway 6, and yours truly, Charlie Lyon. Right now, though, meet the boss man himself, America's favorite cowboy, Gene Autry.
When you're smiling, when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain, so stop your crying. Be happy again, keep on smiling, 'cause when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you.
When you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, the sun comes shining through.
But when you're crying, you bring on the rain, so stop that crying. Be happy again, keep on smiling, 'cause when you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. Well, thank you, friends and neighbors, and welcome again to Melody Ranch. Friends, here's a song which is always popular with you folks who visit Melody Ranch, and we hope that you will like it. Slowly I'm falling more in love with you. Slowly you're winning a heart that can be true. Now I can't hide my feelings, no matter what I do. For slowly I'm falling more in love with you. More and more I need you and want you by my side. More and more I love you as each day passes by. My heart, I know you're sleeping. I hope that you'll be true. For slowly I'm falling more in love with you. Thank you, folks, and thank you, Merle Travis.
Hi, Mr. Artery.
Why, Pat Buttram.
Boy, this weather makes you feel good, don't it? This morning I jumped out of bed, opened the bunkhouse door, picked up a newspaper, grabbed two eggs out of the hen house, and didn't drop a thing.
Oh? Well, what's so wonderful about that?
Ain't no string on my pajamas.
Oh.
But, Mr. Artery, I sure feel so good. I'm thinking about taking a course at night school this fall.
That's so?
Yeah.
Just how much schooling have you had, Pat?
Well, I was honor student in my first year of college, but I had to quit. You see, I was...
Now, wait just a minute there, Patrick. You attended college?
Well, at least I finished the fourth year in high school.
The fourth year of high school?
Yeah, well, I got to the eighth grade, anyway.
The eighth grade?
Forget it. I shot my way out of kindergarten.
Just what I thought.
Well, that's where I got my Ph.D. and my A.B.
You, a Ph.D. and a A.B.?
Yep. A pie head dummy and absolute bonehead. You see, Mr. Artery, I want to smarten up for lost time. You see here, they give me this application blank to fill out. Oh. Maybe you can help me with it, huh?
Sure, sure. Let's have that blank. Let's see here now. Name first.
Yeah.
You've got that.
Yeah, I'll put it in there.
Mm-hmm. Next question is about your birth, Pat. I'll help you. Born?
Naturally, I was born. Do you think I was hatched?
Pat, they want to know the place of your birth.
Oh, I was born in the front bedroom off the hall to the left.
Look, how can you be so dumb? I wonder what your father said to the stork when he first saw that silly look on your face.
Say, that's a terrible insult, and you're not going to get away with it.
That's just what I thought he said. Look, Patrick, there must be one question here that you have the intelligence to answer.
You want to bet?
Well, I don't think there's much of a point continuing this.
Well, just try me on one more. Now, if I don't get to the next question, I'm going to tear up the application blank and go fishing.
Okay. Before the Russian Revolution, what was their ruler called?
The Tsar.
And the Tsar's wife?
The Tsarina.
And their children?
Sardines. So long, Mr. Artery. I hope them fish are biting.
Well, so long, Patrick. You know something? He makes the days seem longer. Well, it's about time to see what the Cass County boys have to say, so take off, fellas.
This old house once knew my children. This old house once knew my wife. This old house was home and comfort as we fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter. This old house heard many shouts. Now she trembles in the darkness when the lightning walks about.
Ain't they gonna need this house no longer? Ain't they gonna need this house no more?
Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix those floors.
Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window pane.
Ain't they gonna need this house no longer? I'm getting ready to meet the same. This old house is a-getting shaky, this old house is a-getting old. This old house lets in the rain, this old house lets in the cold. On my knees I'm getting chilly, but I feel no fear nor pain. Cause I see an angel peeking through a broken window pane.
Ain't they gonna need this house no longer, ain't they gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time to fix the shingles, ain't got time to fix the floor.
Ain't got time to oil the hinges, nor to mend no window pane.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready to meet the same.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer, ain't gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time to fix the shingles, ain't got time to fix the floor.
Ain't got time to oil the hinges, nor to mend no window pane.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready.
Thank you, Cass County boys and gals. That was mighty nice.
In the twilight glow, I see her. Blue eyes crying in the rain. As we kissed goodbye and parted, I knew we'd never meet again. Love is like a dying ember. Only memories days I'll remember. Blue eyes crying in the rain. Dying ember, only memories remain. Through the ages I'll remember, blue eyes crying in the rain.
Well, thank you, folks. Thank you. I'm glad you liked it.
Say, Mr. Artery.
Yeah?
While you was singing that song, a feller brung his telegram in.
Well, thank you, Patrick.
Yeah.
Excuse me a second, will you?
Uh-huh. Is it important or something?
Well, yeah. It's from the U.S. Marshal thanking me for last week.
Well, hey, say, that's right. You never told us where you went last week.
Well, Pat, the Marshal had to be in Washington last week on some business. And he asked me to investigate the murder of a prominent rancher upstate. You've heard me speak of Jim Terrell, haven't you?
Oh, yeah, sure.
When I got there, I found out Jim had apparently been killed by robbers who were after $50,000 that he had brought home that same day. So I started the investigation by talking first to the Terrell ranch foreman.
Well, like I said, Mr. Autry, I sure don't know of anybody who'd want to kill Mr. Jim. He was one of the squarest guys who ever lived.
Yeah, you're right, Gil. But unfortunately, I'm afraid there's a lot of guys who would do anything for $50,000. Say, by the way, did Jim Terrell always have that much money in cash around his place?
Well, hardly ever. You see, the day after he was killed was payday. So $10,000 of the $50,000 was for that.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of the money he got from a cattle deal he closed with the Freeman Ranch over near the state capitol the morning before he died.
You say you don't have any idea where Mr. Terrell kept his money. Is that right?
No, sir. No idea at all.
Well, much obliged to you, Gil. If you hear anything, let me know, will you?
Well, sure thing. Where do I get in touch with you?
Well, tonight I'll be at the hotel. In the meantime, I thought I might go into town and have a little talk with Jim Terrell's half-brother, Frank.
Now, look, Autry. All I can tell you is just one thing. If you find the guy who killed Jim, you better smuggle him out of town fast. Because all I'm hoping for is a chance to get my hands on him.
I know how you feel, Frank. Say, by the way, when was the last time you saw Jim alive?
Why, just a couple of days before it happened. Why?
Did you know anything about the money he had in the house at the time he was killed?
No, I didn't. You see, Jim is a cattleman, and I'm a gambling hall operator.
I know.
And besides, being only half-brothers, we didn't have much in common, anyhow.
How about socially?
We had the same father. Is that what you mean?
Not exactly, but it'll do for now. As I walked out of Frank Terrell's office, all of a sudden an idea hit me. Why not call on the owner of the Freeman Ranch? The same man who had paid him $40,000 in cash. And sure enough, it was from Mr. Freeman that I learned something that gave me plenty to work on. When I returned to the Terrell Ranch, I decided to take a good look through the house. And I was surprised to find papers were scattered everywhere. The safe was open, and the mattresses were all cut to shreds. Yet, for some reason, I didn't think the money had been found by the murderer. So that night, I decided to try part two of my plan. A little after 9 o'clock, I went over to Frank Terrell's gambling hall, sat down by myself at a table and waited. It wasn't long before a group had gathered around the table with me, and then the question started.
Tell us, Autry, are you making any progress?
Well, that depends on what you mean, progress, boys. But I have learned one thing.
Well, what's that?
Well, whoever killed Jim Terrell was after that $50,000. Only they didn't get it.
Didn't get it.
I mean, it kind of looks like somebody killed him for nothing, huh?
Yeah, kind of looks that way to me, all right.
You ain't carrying that $50,000 around in your pocket, are you?
Well, I'm sorry, boys. I hate to disappoint you. But I will tell you this much. I left it right where Jim Terrell hid it. I'd planted the idea. Now it was just a matter of waiting and watching the idea grow. Anyway, about a half an hour later, I walked out of Frank Terrell's place and down a side street toward the livery stable where I kept Champ. I never got there, though, because something that felt like a ton of lead pipe hit me right behind the right ear.
Well, well, so little old man's awake, eh? Your head clear enough to think yet?
That depends. What am I supposed to think of that?
Think about where that money's hidden out at old man Terrell's place. And you'd better be right.
You know, it's a funny thing, boys. I'm afraid that blow on my head made me lose my memory.
Yeah? Well, in that case, maybe this'll help you restore it.
Now, are you going to talk to him, or do you want some more?
You're wasting your time.
I hope you know what you're asking for.
So they really worked me over. First one, then the other. I was tied to the chair, but my feet were loose. So I raked the rowels of my spurs sharply across the toe of one fellow's boot. Seconds later, I got a quick chance to do the same thing to the other guy. Now at least I had him marked for the future reference.
He's out again, Joe.
Yeah, just as well. He ain't gonna talk anyway. Come on, we're wasting time.
Okay, let's get back over and see the boss. He'll know what to do with him.
When I came to, I was shaking my head as if I was dodging sledgehammers. It was then that I noticed the back of the cane-bottomed chair that I was tied to had been partly broken, so I decided to take a long shot on getting loose. I put both feet against the wall and shoved myself, chair and all, to the floor. The back of the chair broke loose and my hands were still tied to it, but I was free to walk around. I kicked the door open and went outside. The cool air felt good to my face, and when I realized I was still in town, I started to walk around on the main street. 20 minutes or so later, I'd gotten the sheriff out of bed, had him doctor me up and explain to him what had happened. Then the two of us headed for Frank Terrell's gambling hall. I want a small powwow, Frank.
What? Autry.
What's the matter? You seem surprised.
No. That is, the boys here and me, we were just going over a little business.
Yeah. Yeah, I bet you were.
Hey, what happened to your face?
Well, ask your two friends here. Maybe they know.
Oh, now, wait a minute. This is some kind of a joke. Don't you think you're carrying it a little too far?
It's no joke, Terrell. After all, we've got to find out who killed your brother, don't we? And I'm getting warmer every minute. Remember what I told you about the spurs, Sheriff?
Yeah, I was just noticing that.
What? What are you talking about? What spurs?
My spurs, mister.
What about them?
If you look at each one of your boys' right boot, you'll see my rowel mark still on them.
Now, wait a minute, Autry. You can't involve me in this.
Okay. Then maybe you can explain why you lied to me about not seeing your half-brother for 2 days before he died, when I happen to know that you talked with him at the Freeman Ranch the very day of his murder.
Well, I guess I'd just forgotten that.
Uh-huh. There's a lot of things that you must have forgotten about, too. As for your two errand boys, they're going to get tried for murder.
Yeah, you can't mix me up with no murder. I didn't have nothing to do with it.
Oh, shut up, Tony. He's trying to bluff you.
Let's take them all in, Sheriff, and book them for murder.
Yeah, all right.
We'll see who's bluffing.
I ain't going to take no...
Don't be a fool, Joe.
Sure, Joe. Don't be a fool. Be a hero. Take the rap for somebody else.
I ain't taking the rap for nobody. Me and Tony had nothing to do with no murder. You can take your own rap, Terrell. Tony and me can prove we didn't do it.
Well, that's enough for me, Frank. Come on, let's get moving. Huh? I know anything about justice, Frank Terrell will get a life sentence for the murder of his half-brother, and his henchmen will go along to keep him company for a few years. And when I said I'd found the money, I was only bluffing. You see, I figured whoever was guilty would go back to Jim Terrell's ranch and try to find it. Instead of that, I wound up with a busted nose and two black eyes. As for the $50,000, it was hidden all the time in an old-fashioned chandelier. Friends and neighbors, it's a good time to count our blessings. And if we've made some mistakes during the year, it's a good time to try to profit from them. We're especially thankful for all of you friends of Melody Ranch and for our friends everywhere. And for you, we'd like to sing, Bless this house, O Lord, we pray. Make it safe by night and day. Bless these walls so firm and stout, keeping want and trouble out. Bless thy roof and chimneys tall. Let thy peace lie over all. Bless us all that one day we may dwell, O Lord, with Thee.
Bless these windows shining bright, letting in God's heavenly
Gene, I think it's real nice how the folks linger on for a bit after our Melody Ranch parties. Seems like nobody's in a hurry to rush away.
Well, I like that too, Charlie. It's so pleasant to have a little chat before we say goodbye. Well, folks, night's coming on and the chill in the air seems to sharpen the purple haze over the sagebrush. We're real glad to see so many visitors at Melody Ranch today. And while everybody has a smile on his face, it's a good time to bring the meeting to a close.
This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.